Bridging the Generation Gap is sponsored in part by East Penn Manufacturing. And by Tompkins Vist Bank.
Good morning and welcome to Bridging the Generation Gap. My name is Ruth Martelli. I'll be the host for today. And our students are from Reading High School. Are you there, Reading? Good morning. Would you introduce yourself, please? Tell us a little about yourself.
Yeah. My name's Eddie. I'm a junior here at the high school.
And I'm Giovanni. I'm a senior here at the high school.
Is it the two of you?
Yeah, it's just the two of us. I believe Isaac might stop in later.
Okay, you got to do more to get some women involved here, though I'm not sure that they'd be all that interested in today's topic. Do you want to tell the viewers at home what you wanted to talk about today?
Yes, today's topic is about the Colin Kaepernick controversy.
Okay, why did you choose that topic?
We chose that topic because it actually resurfaced. It was, I believe, the beginning of the last NFL season. I believe he started kneeing during the national anthem, which again, that's him exercising his rights, I believe. And you know, a lot of people caught offense to it, and he really got very bad vibes against it, and I think it affected how he performed on a national level.
Eddie, do you agree with that assessment?
Yeah, I do. I agree. It's just I want to get one thing off the bat. I'm not a sports like football person, so I don't really know as much as that goes. But even I don't even pay attention to sports. That I've heard of him during the last couple months, just because this has become such a big issue. It seems like.
So. Okay, I'm a football fan, but I'm certainly not a fanatic. I don't know a lot about him. I did some research when I found out what the topic was for today. So, since Giovanni, you seem to be the expert here. Do you want to give us a little background information on him, maybe before the controversy, his team and where he graduated from, and his backstory, if you will?
Hello. I don't know what college he graduated from, but I know during the draft he was drafted by the San Francisco 49ers. He was originally a starting QB, and his rookie season he actually went to the Super Bowl. He took his team to the Super Bowl against the 49ers, almost completed a tremendous comeback. Unfortunately, the Baltimore Ravens won that year. But before the controversy, he was a really great player. He's very consistent. He was known for running more than he was throwing. But when he threw a lot of good passes. These passes were very deep passes, and he scored many touchdowns. And then when the controversy happened, it kind of affected his game. He wasn't scoring as much. Last season he got 16 touchdowns. So obviously that's good statistics. But it started. He was becoming a backup. He was being benched a lot, and you know he just wasn't playing as he was before during his rookie season.
Okay, from what I found out, he went to the University of Nevada.
Yes.
I don't know if that's the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, but the University of Nevada.
It sounds correct, I think.
He's originally from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. He was, I assume, because of the story, he was born out of wedlock. His mom was white, his dad was black. The dad left the family. And so the mom put him up for adoption. And he was adopted into a white family. I think he's the youngest of three kids. Two of this family's sons died from a heart defect. So the family adopted Colin. He's 29, and we just looked up some statistics here. Tom Brady is 39. So if you do the math, it's possible that Kaepernick would have about 10 years left in an NFL career. Do you know his status now? He was a 49er.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you know his status now?
He's a free agent right now. There's been teams that wanted to sign him. They're not sure if they want to sign him. But for now, right now, he's a free agent.
Yeah, and and this is for your reference if you want to go look up some stuff. I found this on the internet. There's a site called 538, and the story was written by Kyle Wagner and Neil Payne 2 days ago. Yes, it's strange that Colin Kaepernick doesn't have a deal yet, was the title of that article. And another one is from the Daily News, also on 329 by Gary Myers. And that one is, why is Kaepernick unemployed? Talk from an NFL meeting. So you can get some more details from that. I have them here, so I can refer to them as well.
I'll take a look at that later.
Yeah, there's a whole raft of stuff. And I brought something in that the crew here put into their system. So let's see. There it is. Can you guys see that?
Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, that's his website, Kaepernick's website.
Okay.
I don't know if you can you read what's on his t-shirt?
I know my rights.
Yeah. And that's exactly what you had said earlier, Giovanni, I think.
Yeah.
And then one of you, what does it say his mission is? Can you read that?
The mission of the Colin Kaepernick Foundation is to fight oppression of all kinds globally through education and social activism.
So what do you think of that?
I mean, it's great what he's doing. I mean, he's obviously bringing awareness into his what he feels is a problem. And I think he's doing a great thing. Again, he has his rights, he knows his rights, and he's just creating a movement. That's how I feel about it.
Eddie?
I absolutely agree. Well, I'm in high school, and I'm not really doing much in that right now, but if I ever do have the opportunity to gain the status that he has, I would probably be doing the same thing, to be honest. I appreciate the fact that he goes out of his way and he faces criticism to protest what he believes in. I respect that a lot, actually, that he can go beyond. I think he even said in his direct quote from a couple months ago that, to me, this is bigger than football, and it would be selfish on my part to look the other way. So I respect him for that. That's very cool.
What do you say to people who say, sit down, shut up, take your $49 million and just, grow up?
There's a lot of opinions to that, honestly, but, that the people who usually say that are the ones who just want to watch football, want to see him play, and don't get any awareness involved of what he's trying to do. I think that's wrong, and I think those people, they should be aware of this. It's like he said, it's more than just a game of football. It's what you stand for, and when you get to the NFL and you get signed to that team and you get that $1 million contract, some people never show the true colors, and Colin Kaepernick did show his true colors, and now people are getting mad about that, and I don't know why. I mean, he's a really great player, and like the two titles of those articles, why hasn't he been signed yet? Why is he unemployed? I think he's a great pickup. I honestly think he's a very consistent player. Has his talent gone down since rookie year? Yes, it has. But that's because he hasn't been playing as much as he has been before. He had all that support behind him, and now he has two sides. One side that hates him completely and doesn't think he can play, and then there's a side that that supporting what he's doing and thinks he is a consistent player. So that's how I feel about it.
We're so divided about so many things in this country. Do you think this is Colin Kaepernick is somebody who's divided us starkly again?
I mean, I don't really think he divided us at all. I just felt like he's just someone who spoke up for what he believed in, and people just decided to divide themselves again.
Well, as you understand it, Giovanni, what's his reasoning? What's behind the taking the knee during the national anthem?
I believe
And Eddie can talk. I mean, I'm not trying.
I mean, Eddie has the notes.
Sure.
I think he has something to say.
Oh yeah, I was gonna offer them to him,
yeah,
but
I said
yeah.
It's
yeah. Well, yeah. His direct quote here says to me, this is bigger than football, and it would be selfish on my part to look the other way. What follows after that is he says there are bodies in the street and people getting paid leave and getting away with murder. But before that, he had said, where is it? Oh yeah. He says, I'm not going to stand up to show pride in a flag for a country that oppresses black people and black people of color. So for me, I think that about sums it up.
So I think specifically he took the knee as a protest against police brutality against black men.
Yeah.
Pretty much that's it in a nutshell.
Yeah.
Within the football world, and again, you and I are at a disadvantage here, Eddie. Maybe Giovanni has the answer to this. But within the world of football, how have other players reacted to his decision to take the knee?
Some players actually joined him during the protest. Some players have kneed during the national anthem. I believe at least three players from the Philadelphia Eagles took a knee. I don't know the names of the players, but many, many football players have took a knee and have joined Colin Kaepernick, and others just felt he was exercising his rights.
And were those other players who took the knee players of color?
Yes, they were. And I believe there were some that were actually white, that there was one. I don't know, do you know what team? We don't know what team, but there was one white player that actually took a knee.
One of the things that's really important today, and I think it's phenomenal that Eddie did some research, you know, I knew a little bit, but what this topic forced me to do was to go back and learn some more.
Mm-hmm.
Has it had any political ramifications that you guys are aware of?
I mean, with the whole racism thing and the police brutality, and it has, honestly. I mean, when this started to happen, I believe it was at the peak of the Black Lives Matter movement and the whole police brutality thing. I believe it did have political ramifications.
If I had somebody here with me who could do some searching, I could be more specific. But during the campaign, and I don't know if it was during the primary or the general election campaign, Mr. Trump tweeted about Colin Kaepernick and not with admiration. So what he's doing has really bubbled up beyond football. And as you say, what he's protesting is something that's been going on nationwide in lots of communities. I'll recommend this book. I haven't read it yet, and now I probably won't be able to think of the name of the author. But it's called A Colony in a Nation, and it's written by a journalist who has a show on MSNBC. Chris, I can't remember his last name, but he talks about how people of color in the United States feel as though they're almost in a different country because of how their relationship is to institutions of power, including police forces. So I guess I think we're short-sighted if we all believe that Colin Kaepernick is a renegade individual protesting something that doesn't affect the rest of us, because in fact it does. So what's your I'm on my soapbox. What do you think?
Well, I just feel like if Colin Kaepernick had a voice and he wanted to create a movement and have supporters behind him, I think that's a good thing. But did he think about, would this affect everybody else? He probably did, and he knew what he probably didn't know what he was getting himself into. He knew that he was going to get a lot of publicity for it. He knew a lot of people were probably going to get offended by it. But he did it because he knew his rights, and that's the whole big thing about him. He knows his rights, and he puts it on a t-shirt, and people think it's just a t-shirt design, but he knows it himself. And I believe Eddie wants to say something as well.
Yeah. Yeah, basically, I don't really have much to add as on to what Sergio said. I think it's just, that's what basically what it comes down to. Like, that's well within his rights. And even within the, like I said, I don't know a lot about the NFL, but it's important to note that they said you're not required to stand during, you know, the anthem. Like, you can sit if you want. It was more just a political statement, but, and obviously that's going to upset a lot of people, but he was well within his rights to do that.
Yeah. I think there are actually some religious groups that don't stand or pledge allegiance.
Yeah.
I wasn't aware of that, but that sounds
yeah.
Right.
I'm pretty sure, but again, anything we say here, anything that you hear an adult say, you ought to double check, because certainly I'm not 100% correct all the time.
I mean, I said at sporting events, some people don't get up for the anthem at all. I mean, they say, remove your caps, stand. Some people don't. They talk during the whole thing.
Yeah.
Or they just, I don't know if it's a religious thing, or they just don't want to salute the national anthem.
Yeah, well, I think there's some people who are rude, and some
yes,
people
there is. Yeah. I was at a basketball game once, and there's a group of kids that were at the bottom, and you know, they're doing the whole thing to set it up, and these kids were talking on their phones, and they decided to go on Snapchat and yell during the whole national anthem, and that was very rude, you know. And I just don't get it. I think if you're playing the national anthem, just stand and just look at the direction of the flag and just pay a little respect. That it's not much, and you really don't have to stand up for it. I mean, it's just paying a little respect to the country.
I watched the Reading High boys basketball game on TV the other night, last weekend, and I never timed the Star Spangled Banner being sung, but at most sporting events, people start cheering before the end of the song anyhow.
Yeah.
So, you know, a minute of your life given over to showing respect for the country, I don't think is too big an investment, unless, as Colin Kaepernick is saying, there are reasons why some people probably don't get the respect they deserve in this country, hence taking the knee. Do you think he knew he was going to be benched, and or that his stand would have an impact on his career long term?
I think he probably knew he was going to be benched. As a fan, I knew he was eventually going to get benched for it, depending on the stances that his coach takes. But knowing as a fan how some things happen, and not another quarterback that I know, Johnny Manziel,
mm-hmm.
He's partying all the time. He's causing a lot of controversy. He's getting arrested. He eventually got benched for, you know, showing disrespect to the team. And usually when things start affecting the team and the leadership of the organization that the team belongs to, usually they do bench the player. So Colin Kaepernick decided, hey, I'm going to do this on my own. I'm going to get attention. And if it starts affecting the team, and it starts affecting the image, and it starts affecting the so-called championship run that every team wants to go on, they're going to bench him. And it was unfortunate that he was benched. I feel like he was going to have a fantastic season. You know, for a backup to throw 16 touchdowns, that's amazing to me.
Who was his coach, Giovanni? I find this interesting, too.
Who? Chip Kelly. He was originally on the Philadelphia Eagles, but he got fired. And then he got signed by the San Francisco 49ers.
And now where is he?
Chip Kelly, I think he got fired again.
He did get fired again. And so from what I was reading, because Chip Kelly and somebody else in the organization whose name I can't recall, because they were fired earlier in this year, people thought maybe Kaepernick would go back to the 49ers and things would be a little bit more amenable to him becoming yeah. part of the team, either as the starting quarterback or the backup.
Mm-hmm.
But then for whatever reason, and I'm not clear why this happened, he declared free agency. and he's been a free agent for at least a couple months.
Yeah.
And that's the basis of these articles.
Yeah, I just feel maybe he didn't feel the support he wanted when he was in San Francisco. And maybe seeing that his coach got fired, he probably thought he was going to get the same treatment. If he got re-signed with the 49ers, maybe he would have got benched more. Maybe we wouldn't be able to see him at all. And it wasn't because of talent, you know? Yes, his talent did decrease, but he is a consistent player.
Well, I think maybe it would be helpful, and again, you'll have to help me, and I feel bad that Eddie and I are kind of in the same position where we're not geeks when it comes to football. But I know this much. Who was the guy who played for the Ravens who was videotaped beating his girlfriend in an elevator? Was that Ray Allen?
Ray Rice.
Ray Rice.
Yes.
Okay. And what happened to him?
I believe he was released from the Baltimore Ravens and never got signed again.
Okay.
And I think that was a couple of days after the video surfaced. It was a no-brainer. He was getting released.
And if you compare that with Kaepernick, can you compare the two?
I don't think they're comparable at all. What Ray Rice did, he beat a woman. What Kaepernick is doing is he's exercising his rights like every American should.
When you say that, and maybe Eddie knows the answer to this one, I don't want to exclude him from the conversation, but what guarantees your right as an American citizen to do what Colin's doing? You say it's within his rights. What rights are you talking about?
Well, yeah, that'd be in the First Amendment, freedom of speech.
The First Amendment to the Constitution of the United States guarantees the right to peaceful protest.
Yeah.
So it's enshrined in the Bill of Rights. It's been there since the Constitution was adopted. So it is his right to do so. Now you can exercise your rights and have all heck break loose, which I think is what's happening with him. But certainly the kind of outcry against Kaepernick is what he's doing is legal and constitutionally guaranteed. What Ray Rice did was against the law, etc. Now there's another guy, and I think maybe from the Vikings, but I'm not sure. Adrian Peterson,
yes.
Yeah, and why did he get into trouble?
I believe he got in confrontation with his son. I guess he was abusing his son.
Yeah.
And it just got a lot of negative vibes to it, but it was wrong what he did.
And is he playing?
Yes, he's on free agency, actually. So he was playing for the Vikings, and when everything cleared up, he didn't get released. He was still on the Vikings, and now he's declared free agency.
And you talked about Johnny Manziel. There's certainly players in the NFL whose behavior has been really awful. And yet, somehow, they don't get the same kind of condemnation that Colin Kaepernick is getting for drawing attention to what he sees as a real violation of human rights.
And there's a player from the New England Patriots, Gronkowski. He's almost like another Johnny Manziel, but he never got in trouble. He's just a normal football player. He's just been doing what he's doing, but he does have inappropriate behavior at times, but he just gets a slap on the wrist sometimes.
Well, and evidently you can deflate the ball in a playoff game, and that's okay too.
Hey, I mean, but they had a really impressive Super Bowl performance. I mean, I hope that you saw that the 28-3 deficit, they came back. I find it impressive. So, you know, it wasn't bad officiating or anything. It was just a clean game. And they proved that they're talented.
Now, there are some people in football who will tell you that there's nothing about the Pats that's clean, but we won't go there.
No,
there's been a lot of criticism about that.
It's a whole argument that won't end.
Yeah. And when you're talking about something like, there's a lot of money in football.
Yes.
You know, when you think about how much some of these coaches, let alone the players, but coaches are making phenomenal amounts of money.
Yes, they are.
As are owners and such. Have you gone to a live game? Giovanni?
No, I haven't, but I've been to arena football games. I mean, that's the closest I got to a football, actual football game.
Yeah, I don't think I could afford to go.
No, I really enjoy just sitting down with my family and watch it from a local provider that actually provides the games. Most of them are Philadelphia Eagle games. I'm a Steelers fan myself. But
well, I'll talk to you despite that.
Yeah.
I mean, if I have to.
Of course. But I enjoy sitting down and just watching the game. I would enjoy going to a game, but it's just really expensive. I think you could just do it at your home and spend time with family.
So, do you guys know whether or not Kaepernick has put his money where his mouth is, in terms of he's drawing attention to a problem? Is he doing anything to make that problem not go away? I don't mean that, but ameliorate the problem. And can we get Eddie back in here somehow?
Yeah.
I feel as though it's a show of you and me.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to be honest, I think I heard something about him like getting into philanthropy lately, which I don't have too much about in my notes. It's just, as far as he first started doing that, I believe it was back in November, I want to say, that he first started kneeling. Around that time, I don't think he was really contributing a lot of money to it, because I was reading a lot of articles, and that's kind of one of the criticisms that they had, is, you know, he was saying all these things, you know, supporting Black Lives Matter, but I don't think he... I don't think he contributed any money at that time. However, I'm reading here that just like, I want to say like a week ago, he just donated like $1 million to charity, or like I think that was around the number, so.
I think in October, Eddie, or November, he pledged $100,000 a month for 10 months, which is $1 million. And he started with contributions to organizations in the Bay Area, because, you know, obviously because of the 49ers,
yeah.
And in Milwaukee, where he was originally from. And from there, his donations have branched out across the country. If you go on his website, supposedly, I did not do this, I looked at some information, but not on his own website, there's a detailed list of how much he's given and to what specific organizations he's given money.
Do you happen to know the name of the website, by any chance?
If it's the one that we looked at, yeah, try www.kaepernick7.com.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I'll have to look that up. I'll look that up later.
Yeah. And most recently, from what I can gather, Eddie, he's given money to Somalia.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, I didn't do much research in that regard, because that's a little newer. I actually, the funny thing is, I actually had gotten this article from back, I don't know if this was like, oh yeah, it was, yeah, it was November, and I don't know, I've just written a few things, so a lot of my information, I have some information here, but it's a bit older, so as far as the newer things, as far as his charities, I'm not too knowledgeable of those things at this point.
Well, and something I read that really made me cross at him and about 10 million other people,
yeah,
he did not vote in the election.
Really? Well, that kind of shocks me. I would have thought he would.
I would have thought so, too, but... maybe it just seems counterintuitive. If you're going to take a stand rooted in the Constitution,
I agree.
Then you ought to be in a voting booth. You know, I'm just going to try to find this quote.
Okay.
So talk among yourselves.
Well, yeah, about that. I think Gio just had to leave for CTC, and Isaac still isn't here. So at this point, it's just you and me.
Okay. Well, now we're in deep dew because neither of us is a.
I'm sorry, yeah, I just got word from Mr. Brown that he's calling Isaac's class, so he may come in
okay.
Shortly.
Well, do you know what's going on in Somalia at the moment that would persuade Kaepernick to give money there? It's okay to say you don't.
Yeah. I'm not sure what's in specific, maybe. Other than maybe, you know, I don't know. Well...
There's a famine, and a pretty bad one. And I guess The UN says it's going to be a real humanitarian disaster if people don't start giving giving money to help Somalia.
Yeah.
And at the same time, I don't, again, whether this isn't related to the famine directly, I don't think.
Yeah.
But Somalia is one of the countries that's part of the travel ban that was introduced by the president.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, evidently, and I don't have the date. Yes, I do. No, I don't. But anyway, the Trump's tweet was keeping was something about keeping Colin Kaepernick out of a job.
To keep him out of a job?
Yeah.
That sounds kind of threatening.
Kaepernick, because they did not want to fake, our inner cities will find a rebirth of hope, safety, and opportunity. Your San Francisco quarterback, I'm sure nobody ever heard of him. And then he went on to say, it was reported that NFL owners don't want to pick him up because they don't want to get a nasty tweet from Donald Trump. Do you believe that? I just saw it. I just saw that. So he was taking credit for keeping Kaepernick out of a job for what that's worth.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that sounds believable, but I don't that if that is the case, then that, like, if you're the president, why are you worrying about a football player? I don't know. That sounds kind of silly. But
okay. What else do you have, Eddie?
Well, I have quite a lot of stuff here. Okay, my main stance is that I actually necessarily don't agree 100% with some of the things that he said. However, it's important that to myself, while I was conducting research, and all the other people out there who were just bashing him, just, you know, for whatever reason, that, you know, that does take a lot of courage to do what he did. And ultimately, I respect him, because in my own way, like I said, I would have done the same exact thing in his position. Like, if he sees something, it's well within his rights to call that out. And that the whole issue here seems to be an issue of free speech and what's appropriate to say, what's not appropriate to say. And to those people, I would say it's also well within your free speech rights to criticize him, as well as he's criticized, you know, things that are happening in our country. So it kind of goes both ways in situations like that.
I'm sure if you do something as like he chose to do, then you have to be a big boy and take the good comments with the not such good ones. But when it gets to be character assassination, you know, when his character is attacked, then I think you've gone beyond free speech.
Yeah, I absolutely agree, because that's not fair at all to criticize him so hard and to bash him so hard to the point where it affects his you know, his performance in the games, which in turn has an effect on his career, which has an effect on his money, on his, you know, his life, his entire life. That goes way too far.
This is something else I don't know the answer to, and maybe you can find out if you decide to research this further. I don't know that he ever had endorsements.
I could do some research, but I'm not sure.
I wonder if he did have them, if he's lost them over this whole controversy.
Yeah. Well, if he did, then I'm sure that would make sense. That I mean, because I personally know a lot of people. Well, not know them personally, you know, but I watch a lot of people, and there's people that I know that are entertainers that put themselves in a position like that where they act within the law, like they're not, you know, doing anything illegal, where they just have an unpopular opinion, and, you know, that affects endorsements because they don't want to be affiliated with that person. So,
well, and for some athletes, they probably make as much, if not more, from endorsements and deals with other companies than they do from their own, you know, they're playing their own sport.
Yeah. But yeah, well, if you are found in that position, then that's kind of unfortunate. But then again, that's another reason I really do have, like, I have genuine respect for him, that he's willing to risk that in order to protest what he thinks is right. So that's pretty good, actually.
Eddie, what's your last name?
Alvarez.
I've never personally had this problem because I'm not a black dude. I'm not a black man.
Mm-hmm.
But even the president of the former president of the United States said that when he would even go shopping, into any kind of store, immediately there would be somebody following him.
Yeah.
You know, because there's that perception, whether we want to admit it or not, that, you know, there are behaviors that are hung on men of color for, you know, prejudicial reasons, I suppose.
Yeah, I'm sorry, yeah.
So, for those people, again, it comes to, if you looked at Colin Kaepernick when he was graduating from high school, he didn't have a fro. He's fairly light-skinned. What I would love to know, and don't, and maybe it came across in your research, was there one particular thing? Was it Michael Brown? Was it something that galvanized him to behave in the way that he did? And I don't know the answer to that.
I don't know any particular events that took place, but as, like I said earlier, the closest thing that we have here is the quote that there are bodies in the streets and getting paid leave and getting away with murder. Now, I can kind of get behind that because, you know, I'm Puerto Rican, so I know that that's a large problem in my country where, you know, people of my descent and my race are being killed. I would naturally get upset about that after hearing about it so much, but so I can get behind that.
But as a Puerto Rican, you're an American.
Yeah.
You know, you're part of this country. There are people who live in this country who don't know that, but you are, for all intents and purposes, the 51st state.
Mm-hmm.
And Puerto Rico has voted several times about whether or not to become, in fact, the 51st state. So you have the rights of an American citizen because you are Puerto Rican, from Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
But there are still people who make judgments about you based on your name, maybe your skin color, maybe whatever.
Yeah. If I could just throw in there, that's been a part of my entire life, like literally since when I could first remember. I don't know if you know this, but my mom and dad, they grew up in Brooklyn in the 80s, so they faced a lot of things, I'm going to say one over the other, but anyway, the point being is that my dad raised me, saying to me all the time that I have to work extra hard at school, I have to do things, I have to stand out simply because of my last name, because there are odds against me because of where I'm from here in Reading, and also who I am, the color of my color of my skin, my last name. And I'd be lying if I said there weren't times where I was kind of profiled. Like, I remember, you know, me and my cousin was walking around one time, and we were just in a store, and we were just being not very subtly just like followed around. So I just, little things like that, that does get under your skin after a while. But again, I'm part of the belief that I'm not going to use that as a crutch. Not to say that other people do, but I like to believe I live in a country where if you work hard enough, like if you have the capability and the talent to do something, then you could grow up to become whatever you want to be despite all of that. Even if there are things against you, I just like to believe that I'm not going to use that as an excuse for why I can't be successful in the things that I do.
Your father was a smart man.
He is. He's very intelligent, actually. I'm very lucky.
Well, and yeah, you're doubly lucky to have him as a role model and then to put your faith in what he's taught you to do.
Absolutely, yeah.
Huh. All right, Eddie. We need to get you videographed and put online somewhere, because it's a powerful thing to know. And then to figure out that you're not at the mercy of anybody else. You really are at the mercy of your own drive and your own belief in yourself. How has JROTC impacted you, Eddie?
Well, it's funny that you mentioned that, because it kind of fits into the entire narrative here. It fits into the whole entire theme, because it goes back, I'm just going to say this real quick. I completely respect what he's doing. I have no personal qualms with him. However, there is a small part of me that does get kind of offended when you, in his case, it's understandable. But, you know, here in school, we do the pledge every morning. There's people in my homeroom that, you know, just sit down, talk on their phones. And I have a huge problem with that. Like, that does kind of irk me, because I consider myself a patriotic person. I have family that's in the military. I myself plan to go in to enlist someday. And I like to think that I want to do it because somebody has to, because, you know, people have to go down and do, you know, they have to do ugly things so people can be safe at the end of the day. Like, people of all races have died to make this country what it is today. And it would make me very proud to contribute to that. And that's kind of why I joined JRTC. A lot of people do it, you know, not to bash them or anything, but they just do it because they see it as something to do, I guess. They just like to do physical activity, which I do too, but I always saw a deeper meaning in it. It was always a stepping stone to something larger, to be part of something bigger than myself, something noble. You know, like, that's always been my reasoning for it. Like, I just, that lifestyle feels right for me. But, yeah.
Wow. Now we really have to get you on videotape. Years ago, and I don't know if this is fair, one of the things I loved about seeing JROTC at the high school, but my family and I have a scholarship that we give every year, so we come to the awards assembly.
Yeah, usually show up to those.
Yeah, there are always JROTC members handing out programs and standing at the doors and being polite and gentle person-y, since there are men and women there, but young men and women there.
Yeah.
One of the things that I really am impressed with is the diversity within the JROTC.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And, I don't know, 5 years ago maybe, I directed a show called Hats. It's a history of African Americans in this country. And I contacted, and I don't know if he's still there. Who's your Sergeant Major?
Right now it's Sergeant Major Wright.
That's who I dealt with. And I called him, and he sent me some kids from the drill team.
Mm-hmm.
And they performed in the course of this play. And they brought the house down. Eddie, it was the most remarkable thing. They did their drill. People were on their feet screaming and clapping. It was just wonderful.
Yeah.
So people who... Now, I don't know how kids at the high react to you guys. Do you get that kind of respect and attention there?
Well, I mean, just up until recently, I wasn't part of the drill team. I was part of it for like 2 years, and then I dropped out. But yeah, you absolutely do, because it feels good. It feels really good, you know, because for drill, you got to wake up at like 6 o'clock, or no, not even, you got to wake up early because you have to be at school by 6 o'clock. So, you know, to do all that, to go through all that, and to, you know, to actually perform in front of a crowd and get that sort of, that reaction, it feels really good. It reminds you of why you're doing what you're doing.
How did the non-JROTC kids react to you guys? Do you get positive vibes from them?
Yeah, we do, actually. It's pretty nice. They always, I mean, I'm not one to say, but I guess this year would be like the first year where I observed the drill team performance was like in the school.
Uh-huh.
And I never actually got to make it on the varsity team, but just watching them, even me still, after practicing and going through that stuff myself, I still get amazed, honestly. Like, I still, it's awesome to see. So I can only imagine how they feel, but they usually react pretty well to it. Like, they would stand and applaud. It's cool.
One of the things that I also am so grateful for in terms of JROTC at Reading High School is the number of young people who've wound up at the Naval Academy, winning scholarships there because of their participation and the excellence of their you know, their participation in JROTC.
Yeah.
But isn't it interesting, and you know the old argument about the which came first, the chicken or the egg?
Yeah.
So you're talking about being a soldier, defending my right to free speech,
mm-hmm.
which means that I have the right to speak against the military.
Yeah, that's well within your rights. Yeah.
Yeah. So you guarantee a right that maybe you're not that pleased with, but in the course of your service in the country, that's really what you're defending.
Yeah. What do you think when you say that? I'm reminded of this quote. This is a very famous quote, and I should know who said it. And forgive me for not, it slips my mind at the moment, but there, you know, there's the quote of saying, I don't necessarily, well, not like that. I can't even remember the quote correctly, but anyway, it's saying, I don't necessarily agree with what you have to say, but I will defend.
And your right to say it.
Your right to say it, yeah.
Yep.
I can remember the quote, but yeah.
Yeah.
That, yeah.
And I think in many ways, Eddie, that's really what makes this country so special. People talk about American exceptionalism, and I don't really know what that means
mm-hmm.
when other people say it. But I think the conversation you and I are having right now is what makes it us exceptional.
I agree.
That you can put on a mantle that says, I'm going to fight for my country and defend its values. And those values include allowing American citizens to criticize you.
Yeah, because at the end of the day, that is what creates a healthy democracy, even if you don't agree with it. Because, yeah, because this whole thing of division within the country, ever since, you know, the uprise of, you know, the Black Lives Matter movement, the elections, all this other stuff, that, yeah, it's kind of hectic and it gets chaotic sometimes, but at the same time, it's necessary because it shows that people within the community, just people who would be considered nobodies, really. I mean, they're not in any form of government or anything, but that they're able to make such an impact on society is pretty awesome, if you ask me.
Well, and one of the things that I think is so important about how you prepared for today, and it's something that I try to say to every group of kids that I talk to.
Yeah.
The more information you have, the more you know, the more you're going to figure out you don't know. But using the tools that you've been taught by your dad and other people to find the answers to questions that you have, to have historical context for things that are happening, is a habit that if you get into, you will never regret. Because always you'll know how to find out maybe 16 answers to a question where you thought there was only one answer.
Yeah, absolutely. And that, I'm sorry.
Go ahead. No, what were you going to say?
No, that's actually something that kind of hit me like a train when I was, because here's the thing, when I was talking about that, you know, like the uprise of, you know, the BLM and the election and all that, that's kind of when I started to get into politics, because my whole life, as far as I knew about politics, it was stuff that I heard from my dad. Or stuff that I'd see on SNL and their parody. Yeah, that was the extent.
But at least that's a funny way to find out about politics.
Yeah, you know, like, you know, they do the weekend update and thing. But yeah, just up until recently, though, I started to do my own research because I formed my own opinions. So I wanted to build more on that and I wanted to get informed. And it blew my mind how this whole thing is just, before, when I was younger, it just seemed like it was right versus wrong, like these guys are this and this is that, but it really is just a whole matter of perspective, and it's just, because, like, you know, just, you know, there's this whole thing right now going around, like hate speech and bigotry and all this, and while there are absolute things like that, from what I've seen, a majority of it just seems to happen to be, like, people with different opinions who just don't conform with the overall narrative, that's the word I was looking for. But yeah, it seems like it's just all a matter of perspective, and I'm grateful that I can see both ways, because the last thing I'd want is to become a totally left-wing or right-wing person who would defend the worst person ever just because they happen to be on your side, or just end up hating the other side and not even knowing why. It's just that thought scares me. So that's kind of what inspired me in the first place to, you know, start conducting my own research, get more informed, so I can, you know. I think you understand.
I think I'm so proud of you because what you're talking about is what everybody should try to do. And I think I try. I'm probably biased in my political views.
I am too. I think everybody is in some form of way.
But my mom taught me a long time ago, and she never, God bless her, got out of the 10th grade because women didn't need an education in 1918 or 1928, whatever. But she always taught me the rule of three. Whether it was buying something, you know, you got three opinions. And then because we didn't have very much money, you threw out the most expensive because we couldn't afford it. You threw out the least expensive because it was probably not very good, and you took the middle.
Mm-hmm.
And just what you're saying about research and looking at different points of view, if you can do that and look at three different approaches, read three different sources, and from those three, you can come up with your own opinion of what's true.
Right, yeah. I think that's a pretty good world to go by.
Can you imagine yourself in politics, Eddie?
Well, I would go that far. I wouldn't go that far. It's a bit too messy for me, to be honest. I prefer just, you know, a life of just going out and doing your job without having to worry about things like that. But, you know. However, if it did happen someday in the future, I can't say I'd be necessarily surprised, since my way of doing things and my way of looking things eventually leads me into that. Because there's no doubt that, you know, that's one of the best ways to make a difference, to you know, get your voice out there, is by doing politics. But then again, at the same time, it's a tricky game, you know, because it almost seems like nobody in that business too long stays good, stays the way they are. And that's the last thing I want for myself. Like, I don't want to lose what made me who I am in the first place. So that's, yeah.
Well, if I remember correctly, are you planning to go into the Marines after graduation?
Not immediately, but yeah.
And what will you do immediately?
Well, immediately I'd start looking into colleges, you know, looking for a job, maybe a small apartment, maybe, but just, you know, start getting things together.
Have you applied to colleges, or is that not on your radar?
Not at this point, but over the summer and, you know, obviously beginning my senior year, that's going to be a big objective for me.
I beg your pardon. You're only a junior.
Yeah.
I was thinking you were a senior. So you have a whole, you have pretty much a year to decide. Right?
Well, yeah. I guess you could say that, but then again, my dad would disagree with you. He always tells me, like, it's never too early. Like, you should already know, you know, more or less what you want to do and this and that. But yeah, and I absolutely agree. He's right. Like, I'm not, you know, I'm just, I just need to be more sure in what I need to do. That is true, but it's just, it is a little overwhelming, and I'm kind of an easily overwhelmed person sometimes. So
pressure is not always a good thing. And I can see, yeah. I wouldn't want to be 18 again for all the tea in China. I was 18 when it wasn't, well, that's not true. I was 18 when the Vietnam War was going on and all those things were happening. That's another whole issue.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of pressure. And what are you, 17?
Yeah, 17.
Yeah. You don't always know at 17 what's going to suit you when you're 35. Because sometimes you make the bad choice, and then you wind up being a little bit older and saying, what the heck is wrong? You know, why did I do these things? Yeah. So tell your dad that I told you to tell him you can take your time.
I'm probably going to watch this with him, because I'm sure he's probably watching right now. So
I think I know what your father would say to me, too. Well, we have like 2 minutes left. How do you want to wrap this up?
Well, let's see. I think we've covered a lot of more or less what I wanted to talk about. It's just, If I had something to say to conclude this, you know, to wrap up everything I wanted to say in a point, it would just be that free speech is very, 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 very important. I'm a huge advocate for free speech. However, it doesn't always go one way. You know, you do need to listen to both sides, because you need to listen to, a government needs to listen to its people and their opinions, not just celebrities or the majority. I believe it does need to listen to everybody, not just dismissing something because, and again, I don't want to come off as, you know, I'm a defender of people who just outright, you know, are racist and this and that, like they're actual are bigots. Like, I don't want to have any part of that. However, I do think it's important not to just dismiss some people who have a different opinion as just, and the same could have even was said with Colin Kaepernick himself. Like, he's not hateful toward anybody. Like, he's just giving out his opinion, and I think it's important to take, you know, to take that into account. Like, you need to listen to all sides in order to get the big picture, like I was just saying a little while ago.
We have about maybe a minute and a half left.
Yeah.
Now wait, let me ask you something.
Yeah,
if Colin Kaepernick came into your studio and sat in the chair next to you, what would you say to him?
Well, actually, I think that fits pretty well, because like, I don't know if you, I wrote a few words here to, in regards to that article that I read, so I guess if I could just read that,
sure.
I think it pretty well describes what I was saying. So yeah, I'm going to be reading from it. It says, while Kaepernick does not bring up, While Kaepernick does bring up many fair points regarding to oppression of many minorities in the U.S. and the overall abuse of power among law enforcement, I personally do not agree. I don't agree because, simply put, law enforcement and or police officers, I don't believe they represent the U.S. as a whole. And I don't think they should be the reason for one refusing to honor a flag or one's country because of the actions of a few police officers. So, let me see. While we are not without flaw, as hardly anything or anyone is, we are still a nation that believes in liberty and justice for all. In my opinion,
Eddie,
the problem... Yes, I'm sorry.
I just got the sign for goodbye.
I'm sorry.
It's not you. But thank you for what you just said.
Yeah.
And you're a fine young man, and I think we'll be hearing more from you.
I will definitely come back here again. Yeah, I like doing these things.
Okay. Thank you, Eddie.
Bridging the Generation Gap is sponsored in part by East Penn Manufacturing. And by Tompkins Vist Bank.